Please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we are thankful on this day for the life that you have given to us in and through Jesus Christ. We pray right now that you would send your Spirit among us, that we might continue to be thankful for that life and while in this life, serve you all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. For grace, mercy, and peace be yours this day from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The text for this morning's meditation comes to us mainly from our epistle lesson in 1 Peter chapter 4, read just a few moments ago. When I was younger, my family, we took a trip to Table Rock Lake, just outside of Branson, Missouri. Beautiful place to go. Yeah, I'll give a second on that. Beautiful place to go. I can remember that trip fairly well, which says something, because as a child, it wasn't a good vacation unless I was actively doing something, right? That's what kids do, but that wasn't the case with Table Rock Lake. It was just beautiful. I can remember sitting out of my great aunt and uncle's deck and just looking over all the scenery, the beautiful trees, the deer that were running back and forth, the hummingbirds that would hum their way along to the one feeder to the next, and they would, you know, were skittish and would walk close to them, and the squirrels, and it was just beautiful, the lake in the distance. I loved it, really enjoyed it. One morning, though, I got up early, went onto the deck, and sat in the rocking chair, and just kind of going with the rhythm of nature, so to speak. When my great uncle brought out a glass of orange juice, he had orange juice for him and orange juice for me. He gave it to me, and we were just sitting there rocking together. And you could kind of sense what I was saying or thinking in this newfound freedom away from the city life. And he said, "You know what, Jacob?" I said, "What?" He goes, This is life. This is living. Do you have those moments? Those times you just take a deep breath? Do it with me. Take a deep breath. Kind of nice, isn't it? Maybe for some of you it's driving down the road on a motorcycle. This is living, right? Maybe it's hitting a golf ball down the fairway. I wouldn't know about that. I'm not in the fairway very often. Maybe it's walking along the beach. Maybe it's a date with your spouse. Guys, yes, that's life for you. Yes, that's good. And you're fishing over there, right? That's life. Absolutely. Reading a book, spending time with your family. This is life. That's what I'm thankful for today. I'm thankful for life. That's what we've been thinking about the past few weeks. We think that we are thankful for the gospel message of Jesus. We're thankful for the church that we have that sustains us in the faith. We're thankful for God's presence. And today, especially in light of all the news that we've been reading and such, I am thankful. Thankful for life. But what is life? This isn't a philosophy class, but it's a good question. Some might simply say, well, when your heart starts beating, and from all that time until it stops beating, that is your life. Maybe just from a worldly perspective, life is whatever you make of it. The times of joy, the times of celebration, and the times of love. Thinking back over my life, I am thankful for it. I'm thankful for the beautiful, wonderful life that I have, and though I didn't get me wrong, I truly believe that. I'm thankful for the children that I have. I'm thankful for my upbringing. I have to say that because my mother's here, right? No, I really am thankful for it. I'm thankful for my parents. I'm thankful for my schooling that I have. I'm thankful for my college. I'm thankful for my seminary degree in education. I'm thankful for my internship in Williamsburg, my vicarage assignment. And I'm thankful to be a part of the greatest congregation in the world, Emmanuel Lutheran Church, right? Yeah, I remember, cheers for that one, yeah. I am thankful. I'm thankful. But is that life? Is life simply the good things? Is life getting what we want? Is life all about fulfillment? Is life what we make it? Is that what life is all about? Well, as I was thinking about this, I couldn't help but think of the beginning, back to Genesis. God breathed into Adam the breath of life. What was the intention there? What was the purpose? What was life for Adam? Yeah, being with his wife, no doubt. Overseeing creation, taking care of the garden, naming the animals and taking care of them. There was just this groove, there was this niche that he was in. There was this peace. Yeah, it wasn't just Adam getting and doing what he wanted to. It was doing the purpose that God had created for him to do. This was life. And throughout all Scripture, that's what God does. He breathes into his people life. He calls Abraham out of darkness into a life, a promise, a covenant. Out of Egypt, he calls his people. He breathes into them life and a promise. But how does he do it? Yes, he walks with them and he leads them forward, but he gives them those great rules, right? Those Ten Commandments. A lot of people look at it and say, oh, that's so restrictive. No, this is life. This is good for them. As they are honoring God and obeying Him. No other gods before you. This is life. As they're remembering the Sabbath day and keeping it holy, worshiping Him. This isn't a pain for them. This is life. This is good. This is structure. After keeping all the other commandments and all the other rules that God has given them, this isn't a problem. This is very good. This is life. This is what God has created for them. And it's good for them. And it has a purpose. And then, of course, we see Jesus come. The purpose of giving life. Suffering and dying for his people. That's life. But what does it mean to live? Life might be something we have and possess, but what about the verb? What does it mean to truly live? See, that's the question that Peter is answering for us today. I'm sorry you don't have it in your bulletin, but the first part of chapter 4 starts out this way. He says, since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, that was his life, arm yourself with the same way of thinking. Thinking is a part of life. For whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, so as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, not for human passion, but the will of God. Alright, what's he saying right here? While you are in the flesh, you are called to live according to the flesh. That doesn't lead to life. Instead, you are called to live a way that God has called you to live, which leads to eternal life. So while you are in the flesh, live this way. This is life. While you're in the flesh, do not live this way. This isn't life. In fact, we can't call it living. We might as well call it what? Dying. That's exactly right. So what are those things that are dying? And what are those things that are living? Well, that's the text that we have today. What were the people doing in our text? Well, what does he say? He says, next page, what he says is, as people of God, stay away from the immorality. Stay away from the drinking parties, the orgies, the lawlessness, and the idolatry by doing what is good, by doing what is holy, doing what is God-pleasing. This is what the problem is with Peter. As he looks around, he sees everybody living their life as if it's their own. Doing whatever they want to satisfy the flesh and those earthly pleasures. Right? Because isn't that what life is all about? Making your own life. Doing what you want to do. After all, it's your life, right? You see, the really big problem with Peter's having is that he's seen it happen in the church. Christians lusting after their neighbors? Could you imagine faithful Christians having a little too much to drink? Can you imagine faithful Christians who are supposed to have good stewardship of their lives actually living as if their lives were their own and that they were not bought out of price? Could you imagine faithful Christians believing that what they did in their life didn't matter? Can you believe that? Absolutely. Because we live that way, don't we? We live that way. Jesus in our gospel lesson says this: greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. You did not choose me, but I chose you. Jesus is talking to his disciples. But through his death and his resurrection, through his life and living, he's speaking to you and to me as well. What did Jesus do? Did he live for his own glory? For earthly treasures? Did he live so that his name would be glorified on earth? And that he would be lifted up and he'd be a great earthly leader so that everybody would think well of him while he is alive? Did Jesus do all of that? No. Jesus lived for God's glory. See, that's the thing. When you live this kind of life, a life that is God's pleasing, the kind of life that you're called to live, an amazing thing happens. Not only do you live and are at peace in your life, but it seems like through you, God yields life to others. And isn't that what happened to Jesus? Born of a virgin, to Joseph, a carpenter's son, really with nothing to his name, teaching and preaching about not what was popular, but about what was good and right and true. He didn't live for himself. If he did, he wouldn't have worn himself out time and time again, constantly surrounded by the crowds, having to fight just so he could have time alone to be with God. But no, he gave himself all the way to the cross, suffering and dying so that through his life, life would be received. Friends of Christ, that's my hope for you. That you realize in Jesus, there is more than the life of the world. There is living here and now. As I hear my baby cry, I can't help it, to say how much joy I have in hearing that. The next generation, those babies and the babies to come, how are they going to live? Through the gospel, yes. Through you. I know it's hard sometimes to give up your time. That's tough. But as you do it, it's life. And you heal life to others. I know it's hard to give of your money, but truthfully, that is life, and that you find yourself living in a way God has called you to live, but it produces life in someone else. I know it's hard to have that testimony and to proclaim it and put yourself out there. That's hard to do, but it produces life in other people. It's life. The life God has called us to live. It's not always easy. And it's not always happy. But I pray for you, for every trial and tribulation, every time of joy, every heartache, no matter the circumstances, you're able to pour yourself a glass of orange juice, take a drink, and in Jesus say, this is living. May the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus Christ. Amen. This time I